How did I become such an odd duck in this comfortable world? You know, they got that old saying, you can comfort the afflicted, or you can afflict the comfortable. And kind of what I do is afflict the comfortable. And I'm the lead man. I'm out there. I'm bringing it home. And if it's a trick to avoid lines at the museum in Paris, or find a cheap place to stay in London, or stay healthy in Turkey, or break down your ethnocentrism and realize that, hey, we're outnumbered on this planet 20 to 1, something's weird. When I was a kid, it was rich Americans going down on a big cruise ship in the Caribbean, throwing coins off the deck and photographing black kids jumping for the coins. I remember that. When I was a little kid, I thought that's what travel is. It's rich people going down there and really flaunting their wealth. And then when I got older, I decided, if am I going to teach travel, am I just going to be encouraging this kind of action that really is a problem? And even today, for many Americans, travel is still see if you can eat 5 meals a day and still snorkel when you get into port. You know, and that's just not my idea of good travel. That's not bad. That's hedonism. And there's nothing wrong with hedonism. If somebody works hard and they got that money and that's what they want to do, more power to them. But just don't call it travel. Travel, to me, brings people together. My whole thing is independent travelers. And, you know, if you're an independent traveler, to me, it's a very spiritual experience. For 25 years, I've taken groups around. And even in my secular tour company, we'll have Sunday morning fellowships, I call them. Very inclusive. It's kind of dicey when you sell a tour to have we got to go to church. But on Sunday morning, we have a fellowship. And it's very inclusive. And, you know, it's probably common sense to say God instead of Jesus a lot, because I want all these people who are spiritual but not necessarily practicing Christians to get together and share how their travels are affecting their faith. And it's a beautiful and powerful part of your travels to acknowledge that you're a person of faith. And as you go to these great churches, and as you meet these little children in the markets, and as you walk on the ridges in the Alps, you become very in touch with the wonders of this planet and how blessed we are and how connected we are with our Creator.
Back in Jerusalem,
I have to get my foot in the door by promising people beautiful beaches and cheap hotels and great train passes and, you know, here's how to get the best plane ticket. But there's so much more to travel than just being fed and housed and catch the train. And that just provides you the practical foundation. And then you want to meet people and you want to broaden your perspective and have truths that you were raised thinking are self-evident and God-given challenged. The thought that every year 5 precious languages go extinct is fascinating to me. It's heart-wrenching to me, because I've been with these little groups that are losing that battle. And they don't go out with a bang, they go out with a whimper. It's a slow, discouraging, melting away. And it's tough now because there's a big, powerful culture on this planet. And there's going to be Starbucks on every corner. And I'm the first one to get my latte. You know, I'm part of this movement. I'm teaching people to get on the airplane and have their melatonin so they don't have their jet lag and go over there and not get diarrhea and get some cheap carpets and come home. There's got to be more to it than that. And you'll get your cheap carpets, and you'll avoid diarrhea, and you'll get some good snapshots, but you also come home with an appreciation of what it's like to be an American, and a thankfulness for how blessed we are in our security and in our freedom and in our affluence, but also with a very keen awareness that there are real people with real struggles that do not have the American dream. They don't wish they had 2 cars in the garage. They don't wish they had a college education for their kid. All they want is a thatch over their roof and enough ground to grow their rice and beans and some peace and justice so somebody's not going to muscle them off that land and force them onto a plantation where they only have imported food to buy. You know, Mother Teresa would say if somebody wanted to come and see her work, they'd say, well, think carefully about this, because you're going to spend 2 years' wages on the plane ticket to get down there and back. And she's saying, not saying don't do it, but if you're going to spend that money to get down there and back, you better take home something that makes it a good stewardship. And I struggled with that long and hard when I encourage people to travel and spend that money. When I go to the developing world, I know if I take a photograph, click. That's half a day's wages, just the cost to develop that piece of film. You know, it's very difficult and frustrating when you're a traveler who's been hugely impacted by some travel experience, whether it's a Christian mission to some orphanage or church work in Africa or Central America, or if you're just adventure traveling in South Asia or whatever. You come home, and it's like for me in India. India is my favorite country. I can't talk to people about India. People don't get it. I don't even waste my breath talking about India. I certainly would never take a group to India. I can take a group to Ireland or Italy because I can manufacture the travel fun. And it's not a personal thing. It's a universal thing. Anybody who goes to Venice, wow, St. Mark's Square. They go to St. Peter's, wow, Michelangelo's Pieta. They go to London, ah, Beefeaters. But if I take you to India and you stand in the Ganges River and you watch these people doing their rituals, oh man, I wouldn't have patience with soft first world travelers with creature comfort needs. So I wouldn't be the tour guide that I need to be. I can tell you that right now. And when you're on a rickshaw going through town and getting to know these people, I could not sympathize with people who are bothered by things that are too wild and in your face. So for me, it's a very personal experience. You know, this is an interesting thing to me. American Christians care about other people. We've got good hearts. There's no doubt about it. We really care about poor people and this kind of thing. And it's a little overwhelming for the typical American to be confronted with all these children with bloated bellies in Biafra. You know, it's like, stop it. Let's just support the boys' club and the girls' club here. And our little league needs new uniforms. And okay, we can take a church group down to Tijuana and build a house. Isn't that great? And then come back. I get so frustrated when a church group goes down to Tijuana, builds a house, and comes back, and does not incorporate that compassion in an enlightened kind of citizenship. I want them to be active Christian citizens, mobilized to make our country a positive force on this planet when it comes to peace and justice issues. It's too convenient to go down to Tijuana, build a house, come back, and then vote for your own self-interest. I don't know why more people don't have an appetite for it. But it's not a way to fill your scrapbook with smiley faces and barbecues and birthday parties. Thomas Jefferson said travel makes a person wiser but less happy. And I think that's what travel has done to me. I like to think that. And less happy is not a bad thing. I want the truth. I'm giving people travel and training wheels. They're going to Europe. And I'm trying to give them a little perspective on the rest of the planet. And groups that take people into developing areas, troubled areas, scary areas for mainstream tourism, that is real travel experience. The most valuable travel I've ever had in my life was down in Central America with Center for Global Education. And I was just so inspired by how beautiful these little girls were that lived on these shacks on the garbage dump. Thousands of people earning their living by running after dump trucks as they dumped all the refuge into the dump, and they'd find batteries with a little juice in them and they'd sell them down in the market. These were the parents trying to raise those kids. And people in my suburban American world told me, Rick, wait till you have kids, then you'll get more realistic and you realize that charity starts at home and all this kind of thing. And I've got a little girl who's, 13, 14 years old, and that makes it all the more clear and poignant to me that all of us are equally precious children of God. And those little girls trying to make it on that garbage dump in El Salvador are just as precious and just as deserving as my little daughter. And I can spend $5,000 in a heartbeat to give my daughter straight teeth. And every kid in her class has braces. And we can't come up with $600 to give that other girl a well where they can get some water so the mother doesn't have to walk 5 hours every day to get their kids some food. I mean, it's absurd. You cannot bottle these developing world experiences and bring them home and let people, oh, that changes my whole outlook. You know, you got to be there. You've got to be there to really, well, you don't have to be there, but it's asking a lot of a comfortable American to change their perspective on secondhand information. To go down there firsthand and see it, that radicalizes you. And that's a good thing. I mean, when half the world's trying to live on $2 a day, And we spend more on cosmetics and diet products than we do on third world aid. Radicalizing a person that's passionate about how they're going to live out their faith in their life is not a bad thing. That's a very constructive thing. How do you radicalize these people in a way that actually helps the gears connect and get something done? First of all, they've got to experience it firsthand. And organizations like the Lutheran Church that really see the value in taking legislators and movers and shakers and church leaders in their communities, teachers, down there to see this stuff, boy, that person comes home, and assuming they want to be more effective in this mission, it has a long-term, constructive, positive impact on them. Since 9/12, I got together with my staff and I said, we need to continue traveling. The most terrible result of this would be if Americans stop traveling, close down, and build up bigger walls to separate us from the rest of the world. And we decided then and there that we were going to be giddy flagships of confidence in our society, helping us travel, break down these fears, broaden our perspectives, and then come home and help our country fit better into this ever smaller planet. It's a very important mission. And I, as a Christian and as a teacher and as an enthusiast of traveling, that's my calling right now. And that's why I work in a way that a lot of people think is much too hard.